chapter together. Yeah, we see a big round of applause for her.
Sure, when America turns completely into Blade Runner, we'll all want to move here. And so my memory is coming out on stage, and I had done conventions from the very beginning, in the early 1981, 82, in America Creation Con, they started it all. And when I got here, it was like, you know, like a Mercedes-Benz or a BMW. There was a film introduction for each person. What came out on a panel, I've never seen anything like that. I mean, they don't really do that anymore. So I was happy to press me. I guess that shows you my ego. But I just remember it was being super modern, super. Fans are so educated and friendly and polite and smart, and not that they aren't everywhere else, but especially here. You guys should be proud of yourselves. I know you get sick of each other, but that's an awesome thing. That's right. What else did I do here? I went to took the very expensive public transportation to where is this No Question of Beach? Love everybody and you know, recycle. And it's $50,000 to go to Bonn on the train. Euros. So, but I have great memories of Bonn and I want to go back. There's lots of reconstruction or refurbishment or stuff. I spent some time in the church. Do you know the name of the church? What's the name of the church? Moonstone, that's it. And the organist was practicing. Oh my God. So I sat in there for an hour and meditated. And oh, what a gem of a place. I wonder, do you know Bach ever played there? Oh. Not that means he's okay. Sort of got the whole thing started, you know, Johann Sebastian. Right, I know, but I just, you never got down here? No? In those days it would be in Austin? Okay. And the expression is Austin?
Yes, not Austin, like Australia.
Right, no. Someone answer this question. Outside here, there are these raised rocks or bumps with little lacerations on them, and it's in a path maybe 4 or 5 feet wide, 3 or 4 meters wide. Is that to discourage horses or bicyclists, or what is it to do? Does anyone know? Oh, it's to keep cars in. Oh, I see. Even though it's in a sort of place where there would be no cars. So it's working, okay. So anyway, you can obviously tell I love, truly love there. You know, I'm German, my family's German, they're all coming from Baden-Baden. And wait, am I doing something wrong here? I figured that.
You speak any German?
Yeah. I played a German with this very strange German name. Hans. And joking. Do I need to? I'll hold up my right hand if I'm joking. No, it's Hans. It was on Broadway and it was from a play called The Kitchen. It was in the 20s by Elmer Rice. It was one of those revolutionary plays.
about how all different races were coming together at that time, and they all congregated in the kitchen, and it was kind of politically oriented when I was a young German boy. Played the guitar and spoke German, and would say, du fährst mir, du hast mich schon vom ersten Tag gefallen, give me a kiss, let's go out. What was the other one that I would love singing? Haben Sie draußen auf mich gewartet? Something about it'll come to me. And then at the time I was very young, hadn't done a lot of research, although anyway, I had to sing a part of the Horst Wessel song, which I'm sure you know New York is filled with a lot of Jewish people and the audience, and every time I began to sing that song, I felt a weird vibe coming, and obviously I know why, but I was so naive, but I think that's probably why they cast me, because I was naive. I was from California, I just moved to New York to study, and like that big blonde idiot there singing, he doesn't know what memories he's bringing up with all the people. So, that's,
I don't know.
Let's see. Let's see. I don't know.
I asked you if you were those weekend
Germans. There's a lot of dialogue with German. And it comes easily because all my family's from Baden-Baden, and I think they speak German now.
Kind of.
Oh, really? They're not Osti, they're, what do you call the people in Baden-Baden?
Badenza.
Bad?
The unfriendly word is
not good. Not good, Bad.
Yeah.
Because, you know, in English, obviously, Bad is not good. Good. So every time I see a sign that says bad, I'm not going there. Why would I go to that? I know, Mary. But my father, over and over again. Oh, Russian?
Yes.
Oh. Okay. Oh, okay. Are there farmers there?
See the signs on the Autobahn? Ausfahrt?
Yes, Ausfahrt. I thought that was in poor taste. But
Klassenfahrt.
Yeah, something. It seems obsessed with that one physical activity, but in a country so beautiful, what's that? It's
really not much. When I did a little bit of research, I found some facts about you, and I wonder if all of them are true. You are a champion surfer. You play tennis.
I was in a few contests, but I'm very good.
Okay. You play tennis?
Yes, very good. Very
you,
well.
You ski?
Yes, but not very well.
You guys
so much.
You lift weights. You make pottery.
Yes, very good at that. Won an award for that. Was a champion.
What?
Pottery. Yeah.
There are championships of pottery.
Well, in school.
Okay.
Dictionary, actually. Why they gave me a dictionary? I guess I didn't know how to spell pottery. But I could make it, I could throw anything.
You ride?
Yes.
You ride horseback?
Well, in movies, if they pay me enough.
You paint?
Yes, painting. Piano, you missed the piano part.
Not yet.
That's my big thing.
You play concert piano?
That's all I do is play the piano. It's my best friend.
And? You do stand-up comedy?
Well, I'm sitting down right now, and it's not very funny. But, when I was in New York studying there, I realized that there was more to it than just the play and the background of the character that you're studying. It's life. And on the streets of New York, I was really growing as a person, coming from Southern California and the beaches and the surfing. I was not prepared for
New Yorkers, especially back in the day, in 1978 and 9, there was no way to know what New York was, except you'd hear rumors about the subway. People are horrible, and you know, it all turned out to be true, of course, but the subways especially. So when I got there, it was shocking, shocking. Talk about culture shock. People don't experience that so much anymore, because vicariously through the internet, you're prepared. So when you do see it, you go, okay, that's not such a big deal. You don't realize it, but your body and your mind sort of acclimatizes itself to what it sees. So you look at Hawaii and you see the big waves, and the Banzai Pipeline, for instance. But if you've never seen it before, like I did, and I went there, and you just saw it in the pictures of the Surfer magazine, it was shocking. So that's the way New York was. And I realized that as I started growing up a little bit, maybe the first, second year, I wanted to be something else and be funny. So I used to go to the clubs, the improv, and catch us and stuff. And, God, I met all the great ones. Richard Pryor and Sam Kennison. I don't know if you guys know Sam Kennison. Anybody know Sam Kennison? He's the guy that wears a long coat and screams about his ex-wives. He actually used to be a preacher from the South.
Okay.
He died from drugs, of course, like any good person from the 80s. But anyway, so yes, that was fine. So I did open mic, did that, but I never got paid for it. But I did for a long time. And it helps a lot with acting, because you learn to improvise.
Timing.
Yeah, and nowadays, people are much more funny than the average. You guys are much more funny. The average German is very funny. You know, I do.
They
can improvise, and you can see that they appreciate. Back in the day, that wasn't true, but because we all are media oriented now, we grew up with TV sitcoms. We all know what's funny. They'll talk about it the next day at work. We know much like, and we start to imitate what we see. And so comedy is much more difficult for comedians. So that's why, you know, it becomes dirty and we should as much shock as possible. And, you know, the real good ones don't have to do that. I'm not gonna get on that one.
I asked you about one of your...
No, yeah, not the video yet. That part of the comedy part. Anyway. Back then it was really special for me to see comedians on stage, and because they had rehearsing for the acting company and the Juilliard people, that they are, you know, Kevin Kline and Pat. Does anybody know Patti LuPone? She's the number one Broadway actress, but she was in the company. She was in the class before me, and Robin Williams was in the class. He didn't join the acting company. Acting Company was a repertory company that John Houseman put together to tour the major cities, like English touring repertory companies, where you do a repertory of 4 or 5 plays, Shakespeare mostly. And it teaches actors, you go to a different city, different theater, different acoustics, different people. And it was tough to get laughs, especially young, amateur actors. So I like getting laughs. The comedy clubs, it's just a different kind of reaction. It's beautiful.
So if you guys have any questions, raise your hand and shout it. Oh, first question there.
Hi, I remember you from the bonus session.
I would like to know, you just talked about walking around in front of the convention. So is this something you enjoy? Is this something you usually do if you travel to other countries?
Yes.
Taking your time, visiting cities, meeting people?
That's, to me, more important, not as of this, as this is. But it's very important. I don't know why, it's just a natural thing I love to do. Is, first of all, nature. Sort of born in the mountains in Southern California, and grew up with a deer. So not as green as this, I mean, now we're in
line is sort of an amazing thing. We didn't have any kind of water there. So to get outside and to be with people of different, you know, different upbringing is, I suppose in the beginning, when I was young as an actor, I did it because I wanted to study and feel, and I'd meet somebody and then I'd try to imitate, not imitate them, but understand what how their life, what things happened in their life that brought them to this particular incarnation of themselves. They're obviously evolving and be something later. So I just feel claustrophobic if I don't get out, and I have no context. I hate going to a city and filming there, but not ever having the time. You know, if you're shooting 18-hour days, you never have the time to get out to a cafe, have a cup of coffee, talk to the waitress. Also, there's a lot less nudity that way. That was a joke. So, yes, it's very important to me. And if I had a bicycle, God, you guys have the best bicycles. They go so fast, this normal, clunky-looking bicycles. And most of them are women that are able to just fly by. It's amazing. It makes sense. It's so much more healthy. Now, I don't know. I mean, spiritually. Okay, next.
Another question?
I look for that, but I don't see. They're really there? Okay, that would explain part of it. Because it almost seemed inhuman. And I thought, wow, there must be something in that sauerkraut I don't know. And it's electricity. Sitting in the morning with Johann Sebastian Bach's music at my piano and playing the Goldberg variations, I usually play most of them. And that gets me connected with the great being in the sky, in the cosmos, and try to remember that positive feeling of optimism and carry that out through the day. Try to get out and just make it a day that I can write about that night. Because I journal, I write all the time in my journal. I think I did it back in the day when we were traveling around the country in the repertoire company, just so I would remember where I was. But I got into the habit of it, and it's very cathartic, and I recommend it if you ever, I know it's hard to at first get started, but even if you just do a few sentences and do it again, you start to, you can either fantasize or tell the truth, or I don't know, treat everybody as wonderful, godlike creatures, unless they stick a knife in me and bomb me, and then, all bets are off. You know what I'm saying? Does that, what else? What else can I ask? Is there any more to that? Part B. I mean, it's not about work anymore. I mean, it's, yes, that's it. And create things to have to really have good reflections about. Does anybody remember V, the original one with Mr. Singer? And what is Mr. Singer's first name?
Mark.
Mark. Mark.
He was here too.
Really?
A couple of years ago. Yeah.
How is he? Is he still living in Hawaii?
Oh,
okay. Well, next time you see him, guys.
Can you tell us something about your work?
Well, I was glad that they stopped ripping off, because the time in the makeup chair was ridiculously long, and for the payoff of ripping off your face and to reveal a lizard underneath, I mean, how many times do you have to see it as an audience member to go, okay, we know it's going to happen, you know, it's not, and I think they realized that it wasn't as shocking as it used to be. So they are, because it always happens that the second year of a series, they cut back on everything. Because once it's rolling and it's making money, that's when they stop being really creative and extravagant with their, they don't need to impress anybody anymore. Now they just become gluttons for money, and that's Hollywood and the bean counters and everything that's wrong with this world. Okay, so working with Jane Badler, kissing her, again, not enough nudity there, walking around in the ship, I loved it. At the same time, I was on General Hospital, which was a soap opera. When I was in New York, I was doing One Life to Live, running around doing plays, and I got something that got me back to L.A. And so, General Hospital, when I was on eight, the same network, ABC, so they said, would you come on to do General Hospital? And it was, you know, obviously a big hit. And I had some fun with it in New York. So, and in New York, everybody's a stage actor in the soap opera. So, there were movie stars. Phil Perry has done so many movies with everybody in the world. So I figured it would be the same way with GH, but it was much different. As you walk down the hall, no dressing rooms underneath the stage. From underneath the doors, smoke would be coming out. Marijuana smoke from everywhere. This is a different approach to the work. So anyway, and at the same time, I got an offer for NBC to do V. And I said, is it possible? Could I do both? And they worked it out. It wasn't really that hard to work it out. So wow, was that cool. Not that I was running around telling everybody that, it was just fun to have two. Because in Hollywood, you could do, I don't know what, three or four, and still, it wouldn't be half the amount of work it took to do Shakespeare, you know, in New York. I mean, I did a year and a half, eight shows a week of Richard III on, with Al Pacino on stage. You all know Richard III, the king with the humpback. Yes? Yeah? Do you know what Al Pacino is?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. Richard III would be very pissed that you never remember him. He cut off your heads. So, yeah, it was exciting, and you know, the locations and the idea that it was cheesy, that it was. It looks. Have you seen the original one? I thought the remake was very good. Everybody liked the remake. Of V, or did anyone see the day?
Yeah.
It's beautiful, right?
Yeah, but I like the original more.
Good. But more, the story was more. What?
More or less the same, but newer.
Okay. I don't know. It was fun. It was campy and fun, and yet you had to be serious. And what other actors did I like to work with? Oh, there was the guy from Richard, from Nightmare on Elm Street, Robert Englund. He was on it always. Just jumping out from behind the door or something to scare you and then you run away. No, I'm kidding. wouldn't that be funny if he was like into that? so that was the roof. And that's about it.
Cool.
Yeah.
We have only a couple of minutes left, so I want to know, you worked with Ricardo Montalbán. Did you know him before you worked with him?
No, I didn't. Tina was really fantastic. I was a little bit younger than him. To work with an actor that you didn't even want to be on stage with him because he just stole all the music. But you wanted to be because you could feed off the energy. And Ricardo was the same way. He just, good morning, how's the coffee? Let me kiss you all. Let me stick an eel in your ear. Just let me be, you know, sell you a car with rich Caribbean leather, and then we'll go to my island. It's just a proud man that is from the stage. So I know there's a little bit of a controversy that not in my mind or in Ricardo's mind. We decided between ourselves to be father and son, that would be our relationship, so we could have a more serious feeling when we had our scenes together. So we had that, and I think he wanted that. He had a bad accident when he was younger. Does anybody know that? That Ricardo had a horse? He's a movie star in Mexico. And the horse fell on his knee and didn't get repaired properly. And so as he grew older, of course, the leg didn't grow or foreshorten, and he was off to one side. And of course that affected the back, and eventually the back became such a twisted, painful entity that he was confined to a wheelchair to bear in. And we stayed in touch now and then. I gave him on stage in Pasadena a huge convention and an award for a Lifetime Achievement Award. I loved him to the very end. And I often wonder, what if I didn't get the part? What if, you know, John Savage or Christopher Walken, you know Christopher Walken is? What if he got the part? Because, you know, everybody was up for that part of Joaquin. And we're fighting on the bridge with the Reliant. It would have. Oh no! Wow! Hey, Khan! The shields! They're dropping. This is what it would have been like. Very interesting, but very different. And I often wondered how Ricardo would have responded. It would have been the same. He took over the seaman with the heels and Chekhov. Chekhov, Walter was not into that at all. Could you tell? It was perfect. And Nicholas Smiley, the director, didn't really have to do much. Ricardo was just says, no, that's all right, I'll take these big tweezers, and now this is how you'll do it. I'll just it was fantastic. We're all standing there. And if you look in the background, you see some of the extras. Their shoulders going up and down because he was, and all the while I said, Jensen, you've got to help me with my knee. I don't want to have any showing any kind of a limp. So we discussed, and I said, look, why don't you, like, with mask, when you're an actor and you have a blockage and you can't get through a certain thing, you put a mask on and suddenly you're free. You're free to be, and it's a really good therapeutic tool that people use now. You put a mask on, and you suddenly, your voice frees up, and physically you move a lot more. And so I said, just work through it. Walk like you, okay, if it's gonna be a limp, let me both legs. And that's kind of what he did. Have you noticed? Have you ever noticed the way he walked on the bridge of the Reliant? That it was, what did you notice about it? That it was strong and deliberate, and plus it was horrible for him because it had these grates, these big wide grates, so the lights could come up, and that wasn't easy for the heels of his boots because they could get stuck in there. And that's it. So anyway, I embrace him, and I embrace you all for being so sweet to me here. Been away for a while, taking care of my father who was ill, and so this is really an honor and pleasure, and to be felt some of the prosperous of yesterday, all and
kids' journal. I wanted to write a future.
Thank you very much.
Vielen Dank, dass ihr euch das Video angesehen habt. Wenn es euch gefallen hat, dann lasst einen Daumen nach oben da. Hier habt ihr nun verschiedene Auswahlmöglichkeiten. Ihr könnt oben links unseren Kanal abonnieren, oben rechts geht es weiter zu tollen Videos von diesem Event. Unten rechts gelangt ihr zur Internetseite vom nächsten Event. Zu guter Letzt kann ich euch noch den Space Store empfehlen. Hier gibt es alles Mögliche an Fanartikeln zu euren Lieblingsserien und Filmen. Bis demnächst auf diesem Kanal.